Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I want to talk about types. I'll shortly introduce inductive data types. And I'll talk about type systems, and as an example of a type system, I'll show the simply typed lambda calculus. This last part will also be the subject of assignment 3. So let's get started. A type. What is a type? You could understand a type as a classification of values. And you have already previously seen data types. So recall that a data type consists of a set of values. And often these values have a common sense or common meaning. And moreover, each of the values in a data type must have a unique digital encoding. And this was necessary so that the values of a data type can actually be stored in the memory of a digital computer. Okay, so what other types are there? Well, in the previous video, you might have seen the introduction of a function type. Indeed. But now let's look at function types a little bit more in detail. You could understand a function type to consist of two things, a set of what is called domain values and a set of what is called codomain values. And now, so a function type consists of these two sets and can be understood as itself representing all the possible functions from the domain values to the codomain values. Now, of course, in your particular programming language, it depends on whether it's pure or impure, or whether the programming language has a total or partial function implementations to really understand what belongs to a function type, or whether a program satisfies a function type. But in abstracto, you could understand function types to consist of the domain and the codomain, and intuitively it represents all the possible functions from the domain to the codomain. Okay, so we now know data types and function types. What can we do with types? What is the purpose of types? Well, I might have said this in an earlier video, but the purpose of a type is to make sure that your program consists of additional checks that you, while you are programming, have not made any mistakes. And you can add these checks by annotating variables by their type. And this classifies the values that the variable could take, and this makes sure that you don't mix up, for instance, different types whenever you write down your program. So types mainly are used in the programming context as a tool for detecting the programming errors that you might or might not have made in a program. Okay, so in the context of programming languages, your programs are recognizable by computers, so you could understand programs as strings of characters. So if you want to at some point annotate variables with types, then it makes sense to introduce a grammar for types as well. So let's start with a grammar, an abstract grammar for data types. So let's forget about function types for now, just focus on data types. In a previous video, you have seen many different data types, some example operations you could perform on them. And we could formalize those IDs in the context of a programming language by defining what are the types, the data types that the programming language accepts. Well, as an example of an abstract grammar for data types, consider this D. And so D is a non-terminal. You could understand the zero, the one, the bool, the not, and the int as sort of the primitive types, the simple types, and the d times d, and the d u plus d as the complex types. They are formed out of other data types themselves. So, 0 and 1 we have not seen before, so let me explain to you a bit what are these data types. So 0, and different programming languages use different names of course, but let me just call it 0 here for simplicity. 0 is the simple data type that has no value at all. So is it then a data type? Well, a data type consists of a set of values and it must make sure that each value has a unique digital encoding. Well, and zero being the data type that consists of no value at all, well, the set is empty, and then it vacuously holds that every of its values has a unique digital encoding as well. So zero is it can be indeed considered as a data type. And then you have one, and in a previous video you have seen the void data type. You could also see one as a different name for this void data type. It is a simple data type which has exactly one value. And if you have a data type with exactly one value, you don't gain much information. Because what do you see when you see the value? Well, you see the value. You cannot discriminate multiple values because there is only one in the data type, one. But then we have the more useful data types in the practical programming context, such as bool, which is the simple data type of booleans, true, false. And you have not, this is the simple data type of natural numbers. You have int, the simple data type of integers. And then, if you remember, we had the complex data type of pairs. Well, those we can form if we know the data type on the left and the data type on the right, then we can form pairs of those data types. And the values of this complex data type are the tuples consisting of two elements. We furthermore have the complex data type of discriminated unions. And so if you have the data type D on the left and the data type D on the right, they are not necessarily the same, by the way. You could have different data types on the left and on the right. Then if you form the complex data type of discriminated unions, then intuitively this allows you to make use of the values from one data type and the values from the other data type, but you always know which value came from which data type. So, and by the way, since we're dealing here with an abstract grammar, informally, you could, I just now say so, but you can imagine it's quite an involved process if you want to make it all precise, but you can remove brackets from these data type expressions. But then whenever there's an ambiguity in these type constructors, and the type constructors are the times symbol, they're binary type constructors, and the U plus symbol, that's also a binary type constructor. As soon as there is ambiguity, you associate it to the right. Okay. So then consider now the following two data types. These two data types are generated by our abstract grammar previously presented. We have bool, the simple data type bool, and the complex data type 1, u plus 1. So the discriminated union between the one data type on the left and the one data type on the right. So now you could ask yourself, well, what are the values of bool? And those are true and false. But what are the values of the discriminated union? Well, then we first have to know what is the single value of this one data type. And let's just introduce some symbol for that. So that's this dagger symbol. And then you can understand that the discriminated union has two values. Either you pick this dagger from the left or you pick the dagger from the right. So we also have two values there. But this is interesting because our Boolean data type has two values. But our discriminated union of 1, u plus 1 also has two values. Is it then not possible that we in the first place have defined bool as a so-called type alias for one u plus one. And yes, some programming languages indeed do this. You could see the simple data type bool is actually a complex data type if you make use of these more primitive data types, in this case one. Okay, and if you define bool as a type alias, you can then define true to be the left dagger and false as the right dagger, respectively. So the nice thing is that this bool could be equally defined in terms of these other data types. Well, is that then now also the case for instance, the natural numbers? Could you imagine constructing an expression that is generated by our grammar, which coincides with the number of values of the values of the natural numbers? So and this is sort of a conceptual question. Well, what if we had the following expression? Suppose we had 1 u plus 1 u plus 1 u plus 1, etc. Now obviously this is not an expression generated by our grammar, because this expression continues indefinitely, and this makes the expression infinite, and we only have finite strings that are generated by our grammar. So this is not really coming close to what we already have, but it may be interesting to think about it already a bit, because it's a nice stepping stone to a very interesting concept, namely that of recursive types. Now, to see how we could construct a one-to-one mapping bijection between the natural numbers on the one hand and the values in this, let's call it a recursive type, consider how you could construct, for instance, if you take the left dagger, well, that's one value. But if you then take the right, the bracketing was associated to the right, then you can again make a choice. Are we going to the left or to the right? So if we immediately go to the left, then we have a value. If we go to the right, we can again make a choice. Are we going to the left or again to the right? So let's say we go to the left, that's our value, the left dagger. Or we go to the left, to the right and then to the left. Well, that's another value. Or we go to the right and then again to the right and then to the left. That's another value, etc. So if this process continues, then you could imagine that this generates as many values as we have natural numbers, and then we could associate the natural numbers or define the natural numbers in terms of these values. So this should raise to you the question, hey, are there also these things like recursive types? Well, and it depends on the programming language whether it supports recursive types or not. But we'll come back to that later. This is just intended to raise some questions. How can we understand this? Another example of types would be the parametric types. Suppose you're given an arbitrary data type D, and this, let's say, is an expression in our grammar. So it's an expression generated by our grammar. Now, what if we consider the following, and again, this is a recursive construction because it is indefinite. We consider the following type. We have 1 u plus, and then the pair d times 1, and then u plus d times 1, u plus, etc. You might see the pattern that here we have 0 d's, here we have 1 d, here we have 2 d's. Well, then we here have 3 d's, 4 d's, etc. So then what are the values of this data type? Well, if you immediately go to the left, then you could think of that maybe as, say, an empty list. Or the you don't have any value that is in D. If you go to the right and then immediately to the left, then we can pick a D, because that one is still, we can pick an arbitrary D. Well, you could think of that as lists of elements in D that have length 1. if we go to the right and then to the left, then we are here. Well, and here we can pick two different or the same elements in D. So then you could argue that this represents the lists of elements in D of length 2. Well, and then you have the lists of elements in D of length 3, 4, 5, etc. So, and this expression is parametric because we make use of this D. Huh? So what are parametric types and how could we understand those? Well, to give you a bit of an answer to these questions raised, huh? What are recursive types and what are parametric types? It's maybe useful to introduce this concept called inductive data types. Not all programming languages support inductive data types, but for instance, the programming languages like ML or Haskell or Rust, or I believe also Go, they do offer inductive data types. And you can, depending of course on the programming language in question, then define those data types. So for understanding what inductive data types are, let's introduce the notion of a type variable. And a type variable you could see as, suppose we have this data type expression, right? What if we have also variables that then stand in the place of an arbitrary but yet unknown data type that can be filled in later? So then, if you have these variables, then perhaps you could have a particular expression in which a variable occurs. And then what if that variable then is recursively expanded, so that you take your original expression with a variable and that you then put in the place of that variable, then again, the expression becomes larger, but you can continue this process indefinitely. And this is the sort of the basic shape in which you could define inductive data types. So then we can introduce an abstract grammar for inductive data types. And for that, we only need, and I reuse the symbol D here, by the way, now. Might be a bit confusing, but this D is those for inductive data types. As it turns out later, the one that I gave you previously can also be entirely defined in terms of inductive data types. But what are the inductive data types? Well, you have the 0, that stands for the simple data type, consists of no values at all. You have the 1, which consists of the simple data type with precisely one element, this dagger symbol. We now have introduced type variables, for that I use Greek letters. So here we have the Greek lowercase letter alpha. We can form tuples, so these are pairs of two elements. We can form discriminated unions, but moreover, there is now a binding construct, the mu alpha d. And this should ring a bell. It's a similar construct as the lambda, but this time we use the Greek letter mu. So we have the mu alpha to indicate that the type variable alpha is bound by this mu, and then it is bound within the type expression D. So then, could we now understand, for instance, the booleans or the integers or the natural numbers we have given previously? Well, yes, we could say that the bool abbreviates this one u plus one, because the true you could say is that is just the left dagger, and the false you could say, well, that is the right dagger. Now you could say that the natural numbers, it's an abbreviation of the following inductive data type. You have the mu alpha, so this is a binder of alpha. And then we have another expression, and in this expression, this alpha is bound to the same mu. So now we have one u plus alpha. So to understand what is then the meaning of such inductive data type, well, it is almost as if we are allowed to indefinitely replace this D, for which alpha occurs here, with D itself. So then we get 1 u plus, again, 1 u plus alpha. But hey, that alpha can be replaced by this expression as well. So they get 1 u plus 1 u plus alpha. And in the next step, 1 u plus 1 u plus 1 u plus alpha. And this replacement can be continued indefinitely. And then, in the previous slide, you have seen this 1 u plus 1 u plus 1, etc. Right? We have captured this recursive type. And then precisely as these values could be imagined to be part of this type, these values are the values of the inductive data type mu alpha 1 u plus alpha. And similarly, you have seen previously the data type of lists. So that is this LD. Well, you could say that the data type of lists is simply an abbreviation for this inductive data type. And you might try to figure it out yourself. What if I keep on replacing alpha here by this overall expression? And you keep on expanding this. Well, and what values are then present? Well, then we get the values as discussed here. So we have the empty list, or we have the lists of one element of D. And then, here we have replaced this 1 u plus. Hey, there is some distribution going on here. Okay. So the expression is not identical to what is presented here. But they have the same meaning in terms of the same number of elements that that they generate. Okay, but anyway, these inductive data types themselves form quite an advanced topic. It is not important that you fully understand this material, at least that you know that the concept exists. That we have these data types, that data types are sets of values with a common sense, and that you can assign to every value of a data type a unique digital encoding. And now ways of defining these data types, one particular way of defining data types is the inductive data type. And there is lots of material available elsewhere as well if you want to dive into this. But we will not do that further in this course. And the intention of me here to explain this is for you to know the existence of inductive data types, but not fully understand how they work. Okay, but now that we know inductive data types, what can we do further with types? Well, at the beginning of this video, I said to you, what was the purpose of types in the programming context? Well, it is to make sure that the programmer does not make a mistake. So you annotate your program with types, and then whenever you write expressions or whenever you want to call functions, say, then you can perform this process called type checking. And type checking will make sure that all the expressions that you make use of in your program are assigned types in such a way that the meaning of these expressions are known to the machine. So that you, as a programmer, did not make a mistake. For instance, mixing up booleans and integers. Or for instance, mixing up lists and sets. Or for instance, adding a floating point to an address. Right? These operations only make sense for certain values, namely values within the same data type. You could add floating points to floating points, or you could take the conjunction of booleans and booleans, but it does not make sense to think of the conjunction of one address and another address. This operation does not make sense. However, digitally, so the machines are digital, these operations are just operations on zeros and ones. Ultimately, it all boils down to zeros and ones. So whenever you define, for instance, an operation on floating points and floating points, now whenever you take a pointer and the pointer has the same memory size as, say, a floating point, well, to the machine, these are just zeros and ones. So you could accidentally then perform a floating point operation on what actually the purpose has to be an address, and then this does not make sense anymore. So that is why you have type checking, to prevent these kinds of errors, programming errors, where you inadvertently mix up different intentions, different meanings of variables. Okay, so to formally introduce type systems, and type systems is sort of the definition of the type checking process. allow you for giving a definition of what a type checking process is. For type systems to be defined, let's consider mixed expressions, so expressions where you can make mistakes, and types. And I don't make clear in this slide what precisely do I mean by mixed expressions or what precisely do I mean by types, but I can keep the discussion entirely abstract for you to understand the abstract notion of what a type system is. And then different programming languages have different type systems. Each programming language itself explains or defines what are the types that it considers and what are the expressions that it considers. So abstractly speaking, there is this notion called a judgment, and you write E colon T. This itself is a judgment, which has the informal meaning that E has the type T. So whenever you have judgments, these are syntactical forms, you can then think of a type system as a formal system for deriving judgments. So what do I mean with a formal system for deriving judgments? Well, you could almost think of that as, suppose I have a language, and a language is a set of strings of symbols. And now the strings of symbols necessarily have this form. So it has a something that can be recognized as an expression, then a colon, and something that can be recognized as a type. Then this set is a formal system whenever you can know when the judgments that are in the set can be discriminated from the judgments that are not in the set. This discrimination, you have an expression and you have a type, you form a judgment. Is this judgment derivable? That means, is it then recognized in my type system? Is it in my set? Now, then we write this symbol here, it's called the turnstile symbol, followed by a judgment, to mean that indeed it is derivable that the expression E has type T. So indeed, this judgment is in this recognizable set. And then you can ask yourself the following questions about type systems. These are very abstract questions, but they are very important if you want to further study type systems. Namely, what is the type checking process? So given this type system, so a set of judgments, recognizable set of judgments, is it the case for a given expression and a type that this expression and type judgment is derivable or not? So a process that then performs this is called a type checking process. You could also ask yourself, this is called type inference, if you are given only an expression E, can I then find a type T such that the judgment E has type T is derivable? And if this, not all programming languages support type inferences, but some do. And this is quite interesting to look at on its own. Another question you could ask in abstracto of type systems is, what are the inhabitants of a type? So that question formally is, given a type T, does there exist an E such that the judgment E has type T is derivable? And finally, you could ask yourself of the type system in general, does it have the property of uniqueness of types? So if it is the case that the E has type T is derivable in my type system, is it then also the case that this T is unique? Right? That by that I mean, then if this, if expression E has type T is derivable, then there is not a derivation of E with a different type. So E must have a unique type in this type system. Okay, so these are very abstract properties of type systems. Let's have a look at how we could understand type systems in the context of mixed expressions. And in a previous video you have seen, with this video about denotational semantics, that we had these mixed expressions, and in mixed expressions there could occur variables. So if it is the case that expressions consist of variables, how does this affect the type checking process? Well, we need to adapt our notion of type systems to allow type checking also under a variable context, or and the environment in which you have variables that are in scope. So for that, we need to associate to all the variables in scope, in the variables in the environment, we need to associate to those variables a type that we assume to hold for those variables. And for that, we can introduce the notion of a type context. So, and for that I use the Greek capital letter gamma. A type context is simply a list of judgments, but then of the form where the expression itself is a variable. So that is of the form x, colon, and then an arbitrary type t. So a list of such judgments where the expression on the left is always a variable and then the types are arbitrary, a list of such judgments is the type context. So now we could extend our notion of derivability to be derivability under the assumption of certain judgments, namely under the assumption that the variables have a particular type. And then intuitively, if I zoom a little bit more out, that is, you could say, suppose you declare a variable, well then what do you actually do? You add to this type context the variable and the type that you associate to that variable, and then in the continuation, so in the rest of the program, you then type check with respect to this context. But whenever the variable goes out of scope, then the type context is simplified. You remove the variable that goes out of scope from the type context as well. So this type context can be completely constructed from, it is not a runtime phenomenon. You can do type checking entirely before running the program. And it is a property of the program text itself, what is the variable environment. And now if you have a variable environment, then the type context is just associating to those variables in the environment additionally a type. Okay, so to see these questions, they were very abstract properties of type systems, and we have these contexts. To see a concrete example, maybe this shows to you how these concepts work. So let's consider a very simple programming language and add a type system to it. Well, we previously have considered the lambda calculus. Now let's consider the lambda calculus with simple types. So this is called the simply typed lambda calculus. Now that it is called simply typed lambda calculus does not mean that its types are all simple, because here we have a complex type, but you have to do it with this seemingly contradiction. It is called the simply typed lambda calculus in the literature this way. So I'll refer to it as it is known in the literature. Okay, so what are the expressions in this programming language? Well, the expressions look a very lot like the expressions in the lambda calculus itself. Namely, we have the variables. For that I used lowercase Roman letters. Then we have the lambda. Lambda x, this is the abstraction construct, but now I annotate the variables in lambda abstractions with additionally a type. And then it's followed by the body of the abstraction here. And we also have application as before. So we have two, if you have two lambda expressions, then you can form an application by putting them together. Now, how are the types generated? Previously, you have seen quite complicated grammars for types. We had the grammar for data types, and then later on we had the grammar for inductive data types. Now, let's simplify that all and just consider types that are formed out of either type variables, those are the lowercase Greek letters, or they are the arrow. And this arrow, you might remember that from the previous video, stands for function type. Okay, so syntactically we can form these types by either type variables, alpha, or by function types. And by the way, this type constructor also associates to the right, in case you remove the brackets. But in this abstract grammar, I always just put the brackets explicitly so there is no confusion. So now, quite a big step, but I'll try to explain it clearly here. We can define our type system. And our type system is this turnstile symbol, where we consider judgments of expressions and types. Now, this judgments means that the expression E has type T, and this turnstile symbol then means that the expression E has type T is derivable, but our type system is considered within the context of these special judgments which were restricted to variables, and that's this variable over here. So then we can try to understand when is an expression typable with the type T. So this is the type checking process. If you give me an arbitrary expression E and you give me an arbitrary type T, is it then the case that expression E has type T? Well, and to answer that question, we can make use of the following three rules and the following three rules only. So in the basic case is, what if this E was a variable? When does a variable have a type T? Well, a variable has a type T precisely when, if you look up in the type context and you will find a variable X that has type T in the context, then you know that indeed the variable X has type T. But there is a special trick here. Since this type context is a list of judgments, they're ordered, and we take the one that is the most on the right. So the most recently added on the end of the list. So by that I say you can decompose the list into the individual elements. Well, then you have a prefix of the list, gamma. And you have a suffix of the list, gamma prime. And then if there is then in between the prefix and the suffix, this judgment of the variable x with type t, and gamma prime itself has no occurrence of x, then we could indeed make the conclusion that under such a decomposed gamma, the variable x has type t. So that is the first rule, the basis. So then there are two other rules, and this rule here on the left explains to you how you can give a type to applications, and the rule on the right can give you an idea of how to give a type to abstractions. Well, for applications, we have to check two things. So suppose we have expression E1 and E2. If we want to apply E2 to the expression E1, then it is necessary that under the context gamma, E2 has type T. So it is derivable that E2 has type T under the context gamma. And furthermore, it is derivable that the expression E1 has the function type T2T prime. And intuitively you could understand this application as being a function application. E1 has to be of a function type. So that is indeed what is stated here. E1 is of a function type. And then we apply the function E1 with the argument E2. So that means that E2 then must be of type T. It's as if we plug in E2 into the function E1. And then what is the outcome of such an application? Well, that type is T prime. That is the codomain of the function. So that is function application. Or application. Now let's have a look at abstraction. So to form, to check what is the type of this abstraction, well, we see an abstraction has as a type a function type. So what do? We see a lambda x t. So this is an annotation, a type annotation. And then the body e. If it is the case that the body e has type t prime under the context gamma, but the context now is extended with the variable x, which has type t. This is an error. This should be type t, because that's the same t as the type annotation. Then we could derive that the abstraction construct, where we abstract away from the variable x, is a function type, where the variable x t is the type, the domain type, and the type of the body, t prime, is the codomain type. Okay, so if this is a little bit too much, next exercise class we will practice a little bit with deriving deriving the judgment in the simply typed lambda calculus, so you can get a little bit more practice with how to do this. Okay, but we're not done yet, because remember those abstract questions that I raised that you could ask yourself of arbitrary type systems? Well, here we have now seen a type system, so then you can ask yourself the questions. Oh yeah, here are some examples, but we'll treat them in the exercise classes. So some interesting properties of the simply typed lambda calculus, those abstract questions you could ask yourself of type systems, are, well, type checking. Is this type checking process decidable? Yes. For the simply typed lambda calculus, this type checking process is decidable. So what that means is, if you want to ask yourself the question, does this expression E have type T in my type context gamma, then there exists a procedure that will always terminate. And when it terminates, it either says, yes, indeed, this is true, this is the case, this expression has type T in that context gamma, or it says, no, this is not derivable in this type system. So it is decidable, this type checking process. So that answers, at least gives you a bit of information about that meta property of a type system. Then the question about type inference, given an expression E, does there exist a type T such that E has type T is derivable? That is also decidable for the simply typed lambda calculus. So that's also quite nice. You can do type inference in the simply typed lambda calculus. Furthermore, asking the question, hey, I here have a type T, so it's either a type variable or it is some function type. Does it have any expressions? Does there exist an expression E such that it is derivable that E has type T for a given T? And that is also decidable for a simply typed lambda calculus. And finally, the uniqueness of types property also holds of the simply typed lambda calculus. Now, I want to say to you, oh, by the way, there is another property, subject reduction, but that, let's not get into the detail there. But this simply typed lambda calculus is just one example of a type system for the lambda calculus. Yeah, there are numerous other type systems, many more advanced type systems for the lambda calculus. And those are very interesting topics to study, but they are not part of this course. We will really restrict our attention to the simply typed lambda calculus, so that you have at least seen a very simple example of a type system and know how to work with it a little bit. But the many more advanced type systems out there are subjects for further study for later. Okay, so this is the end of this video. Thank you for watching. So it would be nice if you could leave comments below, maybe saying what you liked or not liked about the video. Then I can use that to improve the videos. So thank you, and I hope to see you soon.